I have attended his talks in conferences and also at TIFR when I was there. And he's an extremely good speaker and he's a very good teacher as well. So I'm sure that we all will benefit a lot from his lecture today. So today he's going to speak about monodromy and triangle groups. So without further ado, let me hand over things to Professor Venkataramana. So over to you, Professor Venkataramana.
Thank you so much, Supriya. Very, very kind introduction. Much kinder than I deserve. Anyway, thank you. So today I'm going to talk about monodromy and triangle groups. So the kind of monodromy we are going to talk about is the one associated to a certain differential equation of order 2 called the hypergeometric differential equation. And in order to describe what a monodromy group is, I should like to begin with some introductory remarks. So I hope you will indulge me. So first of all, I should like to thank Professor Chandrashil Bhagwat and Devendra Tiwari for the invitation to participate and to give a talk, and to Professor Supriya Pisolkar for giving such a nice introduction to me. Thank you. And the kind of the notion of monodromy depends, in fact, very closely connected with the notion of analytic continuation. So let me start with that. So this analytic continuation is also associated to something called multi-valued functions. Actually, as all of you know, functions are never multi-valued. You know, it won't be called a function, but I believe in 19th century, when people were looking at complex analytic functions, the notion of multi-valuedness was routine, except that this multi-valuedness was to be viewed as a single-valued function, not on the space itself, but on a certain, what's called a covering space. So the kind of multi-valuedness that can occur is already seen in the logarithmic function. So the log function, log 1 plus z with some factor attached is this function y of z, which has a convergent power series expansion for mod z less than 1. And this expansion is yz is 1 upon 2 pi I, summation n equals 1 to infinity, minus 1 to the n minus 1, z to the n by n. So this is the infinite series, which clearly converges for absolute value of z less than 1, but it extends holomorphically everywhere on C, not as a single-valued function, but as a multi-valued function, except at the point minus 1. This extension is not single valued. When you go around the point z equal to minus 1 once, the function changes from yz to yz plus 1. You can easily see this. The logarithm, you can view this as the value of the angle. And if I go around the point z equal to minus 1, the angle changes from 0 to 2 pi I. And if I get rid of this factor 1 upon 2 pi I, that's why we have introduced it, then the function logarithm goes to log z, goes to log z plus 1, except that it's not quite log z, it's log divided by 2 pi I. So this can be made into a genuine function on the infinite sheeted simply connected covering, namely C of the space C minus 1, the complex plane punctured at minus 1. So the process of going around the point z equal to minus 1 is called local monodromy action. And one says that the monodromy action on the function is by sending y to y plus 1. Now, this function logarithm of 1 plus z also satisfies a differential equation. Namely, if I differentiate the logarithmic function multiply by 1 plus z, I get 1. So if I want to think of it as a linear differential equation, this equation is not linear. The solutions can't be added, not subtracted. You can't scalar multiply. So if I want to make it into a linear equation, I would like to differentiate it once more, and that satisfies this differential equation, as you can easily verify. Now the solution set of this equation is a vector space. At every given point, if you have one solution, two solutions, you can add them, scalar multiply them. So you get a vector space of solutions at every point. So the coefficients of this differential equation are nice functions, they're regular functions on all of C. So the space of solutions of such an equation is two-dimensional, as I said before, and it's spanned by the logarithm of 1 plus z. You can divide by 2 pi I if you like, and 1 plus logarithm of 2 pi, 1 plus z divided by 2 pi I. So you could also say it is spanned by the constant function. The constant function also satisfies this equation. And log of 1 plus z divided by 2 pi I. Now the Dec transformation group of this covering map takes y to y plus 1 and 1 to 1. So it is actually a unipotent matrix. 1 goes to 1 and the second vector y of z goes to 1 plus y of z. So the it's a 2 by 2 matrix, which is of the form 1, 1, 0, 1, the upper triangular unipotent matrix. So this is a general fact. When you have a singularity, which is what we call as a logarithmic singularity, then the action of the monodromy group is unipotent. So in this case, something nice is happening. The monodromy group is just the group of integers if you parameterize everything properly. And it is hence a discrete subgroup for the group of all translations. So let me take one more example. This is also multi-valued, as you can see. You're taking the square root of something. So you can write this square root of 1 plus z as a convergent power series. So using the binomial theorem due to Abel, you can write this as a convergent power series which converges in the disk mod z less than 1. And this can be analytically continued throughout the complex plane, not as a single valued function, but as a multi-valued function. So the effect of a small loop around z equal to minus 1 is to change the solution to the solution minus square root 1 plus z. So the monodromy action is by the group z mod 2z. So the finiteness of the monodromy actually here amounts to saying that the function square root of 1 plus z is an algebraic function. So this is almost equivalent. The monodromy action is by a finite group if and only if the solution function is an algebraic function. The monodromy action is trivial if and only if the solutions are holomorphic throughout the domain. So let us now come to the Gauss hypergeometric function. So we fix three complex numbers with c not equal to a negative integer. So I'm going to define something like a factorial. If I take w equal to 0, it is just j minus 1 factorial. So it's an analog of this. So I can look at this series g of z, summation j equals 0 to infinity, a sub j, b sub j, z to the j by j factorial, c sub j, where c sub j or a sub j is this quantity. It's like an analog of the factorial. So this series converges in the absolute value of the disk, in the unit disk, and it defines a holomorphic function on the unit disk. But you can analytically continue it throughout the plane except at 0, 1, and infinity. But it's not a single-valued function. It's multi-valued on this domain, p1 minus 0, 1, infinity. So if you want to think of it as a good function, as a function, in fact, you have to regard this space, p1 minus 0, 1, infinity, as something which is covered by the upper half plane. And then this function is single-valued on the upper half plane, and it has some asymptotic behavior near 0, 1, and infinity. And the behavior, asymptotic behavior near 0, 1, and infinity really dictates the action of the monodromy group. Now, this monodromy group is actually generated by small loops going around 0, going around 1, and going around infinity. And the fundamental group of the space is the free group on two generators given by these generating loops, loop around 0, loop around 1, loop around infinity. But it's two generated because there is a relation between these. Loop around 0 times loop around 1 times loop around infinity is the identity. So the group of deck transformation group, or the covering from the upper half plane into this, is the free group on two generators H0 and H infinity, where H0 and H infinity are small loops going around 0 and infinity. So the monodromy group of the Gauss hypergeometric function is generated by two elements, namely the images of these two loops. But as I keep reminding you, I have not really defined what monodromy is. I'll come to it in a little bit. So what one has to notice is that the Gauss hypergeometric function, this function, satisfies, like the logarithmic function satisfied the first order differential equation, this satisfies a second order linear differential equation. And the equation depends on these parameters, A, B, and C. So I'm going to write theta equals z d by dz. Then this Gauss hypergeometric function satisfies theta plus A into theta plus B of G minus z times theta plus C minus 1 into theta of G equal to 0. Notice this, z is, the theta is z d by dz. So theta plus A into theta plus B minus z into theta plus c minus 1 into theta is a second order differential equation, as you can see. It has theta squared terms in it, and that's why it's second order. If you write out this differential equation, what it looks like this, where A and B are linear or quadratic polynomials in z. So the whole differential equation, if you want to make sure that the highest coefficient is monic, you have d squared g by dz square divide plus something like a by z square into 1 minus z dg by dz plus b divided by z square into 1 minus z g equals 0. So the coefficients, if you make it monic here, the coefficients have a double pole at z equal to 0, probably a single pole at z equal to 1, and here also. So that is important to us, that the coefficients have at most a double pole at z equal to 0 and at most a single pole at z equal to 1. So the space of solutions of this differential equation is two-dimensional. One of the solutions is holomorphic at z equal to 0, namely the Gauss hypergeometric function. And the monodromy action gives a representation of the free group on two generators into GL2C. This is called the hypergeometric representation. So far I have only said, you know, this monodromy in very general terms. One can define it more precisely. So what does this representation look like? That's the question. So I'm going to consider the differential equation d of y, where d is that same operator, this operator that I looked at before. So I'm going to change it slightly. In the previous case, I had assumed theta plus zero, so d equal to one. So I'm going to change it slightly because it's more symmetric to when you want to describe the solutions. So I'm going to change d slightly, take d to be arbitrary. So it looks like this. So let's assume that zero is less than a, b, c, d, less than one. We give monodromy representation corresponding to this equation. How do I do this? So the monodromy of the Gauss hypergeometric function can be read off from this monodromy. So I will just describe the monodromy of this new equation. So to do this, I need to introduce two polynomials, g of t, whose roots are exponentials of the roots here, and f of t, whose roots are exponentials of these numbers, c minus 1 and d minus 1. Okay, so to repeat, I start off with a differential equation which looks like this. If I sort of put theta equals a real number t or a complex number t, then I get a linear equation, quadratic equation t plus a into t plus b minus z into t plus c minus 1 into t plus d minus 1 equal to 0. So this quadratic equation is called the indicial equation, and the solutions of the indicial equation, that is the coefficient, the roots of the indicial equation are related to roots of these polynomials. Okay, I don't want to say more than this, because I'll come back to this. So given these two polynomials, f and t, f and g, I can consider their companion matrices. So given a polynomial, one can define a companion matrix, namely just this. So the hypergeometric representation corresponding to this equation is actually given by a representation of the free group on two generators. But what is a representation of free group on two generators? It is just giving yourself two matrices, what the loop around zero goes to, what the loop around infinity goes to. So the loop around zero goes to this matrix A, namely this companion matrix. And the loop around infinity goes to, with a slight change, the companion matrix here, except that you take the inverse of this companion. So this is, I have just described completely what the monodromy representation for the Gauss hypergeometric equation is, but it just looks like a bunch of assertions without any proof. So I want to, the purpose of this talk is to indicate briefly how the proof goes. So suppose I start with a connected open set in the complex plane, and I have two holomorphic functions on the connected open set. So I'm going to consider two second order linear differential equations, which are of this form. So we wish to understand the nature of these solutions. And we note that all the solutions discussed so far are solutions of this kind of differential equation. The Gauss hypergeometric function, remember, had the same form, except that this was a ratio of two polynomials, and the denominator was z square into 1 minus z here, and similarly here. And the differential equation satisfied by the logarithmic function was even simpler. It was just 1 upon 1 plus z. So the notion of monodromy actually depends strongly on this theorem of Cauchy. So if I take the open set to be the disk centered at the origin, there is no monodromy, it has no fundamental group. So the Cauchy's theorem says that in such a case, this second order differential equation, whose coefficients are holomorphic functions on the disk, has two holomorphic solutions which are linearly independent. And the proof of this is not very hard. You have a differential equation, you want holomorphic solutions, so you write down the putative holomorphic solution as a power series. So you have a power series in one variable with unknown coefficients, and you have these power series which are known coefficients, F0 and F1. You write out all the, you know, you have this power series which is equal to zero, which means all the coefficients are zero. So you get a linear recursive relation between the coefficients. And this linear recursive relation actually gives you a convergent power series. That's what you have to check. So it's very easy to get a formal power series solution by simply solving an infinite collection of linear equations, which are recursive. And you just have to check that these solutions converge. So that is Cauchy's proof. And all the solutions are complex linear combinations of these two solutions. And these two solutions are called fundamental solutions. So this has nothing to do with monodromy, because after all, it says that given the disk and given such an equation, you have two linearly independent solutions which can be solved in the disk. And all solutions are linear combinations of these. So now suppose I have a connected open set and I have a fixed point. You know, I would have liked to draw pictures here. Actually, it's very easy to see from pictures, but unfortunately in tech, when you're doing this, it's very hard to write down pictures. So I have to just say it in words. So I have this fixed point. So I have a loop starting and ending at this point. Z0. So I could cover this loop by finitely many small disks lying in U, and I solve the differential equation in each of these disks. So when I start at Z0 and fix a solution in Z0, go around this loop, at each point in this loop, I get a little disk where I, using Cauchy's theorem, I solve the differential equation. And when I move around this disk, I keep solving this differential equation. When I move around and come back, I may get a new solution to this differential equation. So when I go around this loop, I may end up with a different solution. So the solution set of this differential equation can be analytically continued, but the analytic continuations may be multi-value. So the loop at Z0 acts on the space of solutions in a small disk around Z0. This is the monodromy action. This is the definition of monodromy action. So as an example, take a punctured disk. The fundamental group is Z, generated by a circle going around the loop exactly once. So the monodromy representation for this kind of differential equation, where F0 and F1 are holomorphic on the punctured disk. So the crucial point is that you don't know what happens at the puncture. If they were both holomorphic at the puncture itself, then Cauchy's theorem says all the solutions are holomorphic even at zero. So there is no monodromy action. The monodromy action will be trivial. If both F0 and F1 are holomorphic even at the puncture, there is no monodromy. Okay? So the if F0 has a pole or pole of order 2 or something, this has a pole of order 1, then you will have monodromy. So in general, the monodromy representation giving yourself a 2 by 2 matrix in the case of a punctured disk. the image of the generator under the monodromy. So that's the monodromy action. So to really make use of the monodromy action does not tell you everything about the differential equation for a general open set. If you have a connected open set, the monodromy action does not tell you much, but there are certain very special differential equations called differential equations with regular singular points. In that case, the monodromy tells you a lot about the solutions, and it is to this case that we focus our attention. So we confine ourselves to order two differential equations, which are of this form. Second derivative of y plus dy by dz times f1 of z plus y times f0 of z equal to 0, where f0 and f1 are holomorphic. Let's say on the punctured disk only. And f1 has at most a simple pole. This guy has at most a simple pole. And this function has at most a double pole. It's exactly what happens in the case of Gauss hypergeometry function. Then you say, if these things happen, then you say, that the point zero is a regular singular point of this differential. So you may rewrite this differential equation in terms of this operator, which you already looked at, z d by dz. If you rewrite this, I won't carry out the calculation. It looks like this, theta squared, you know, it's like multiplying by z square. And when you multiply by z square here, z f1 z is holomorphic. Z dy by dz is again theta. So it looks like theta square plus f1 z theta plus f0 z y equal to zero. But now these functions f1 and f0 are holomorphic on all of the disks, including this function. So you have just transferred this equation into this by making this by changing d by dz to this new operator. So the assumption that you have a regular singular point is the same thing as saying that these functions are holomorphic everywhere, including the puncture. So now when you have this equation here, second order differential equation, you get a polynomial equation where you substitute theta by variable t, and these functions by the values of these holomorphic functions at zero at the puncture. So t square plus f1 zero t plus f0 zero equal to zero. So this is called the indicial equation, and the roots of this indicial equation are called indicial roots. So to repeat, the general monodromy action on a connected open set, even on punctured disk, does not tell you too much about the nature of the solutions, but it tells you quite a bit if the solution, if the differential equation is nice, in the sense that zero is a regular singular point of the differential equation. And it's only in this case that we will consider what the monodromy action looks like. So if I have this differential equation as before, like this, or this is our theta. It's a second order differential equation on the punctured disk with zero as regular singular point. Then the roots of the characteristic polynomial of the main monodromy matrix, what do they look like? The roots of the characteristic polynomial are of the form exponentials. So this is not pi, but pi. Sorry, there is a slash pi, I think. E to the 2 pi I beta 1 and e to the 2 pi I beta 2, where beta 1 and beta 2 are roots of the indicial equation. You see, as I said, the monodromy in this case is just giving yourself one matrix because the fundamental group is Z. And the characteristic roots of the monodromy matrix are just exponentials of the roots of the initial equation. E to the 2 pi I beta 1, e to the 2 pi I beta 2. So if beta 1 minus beta 2 is not an integer, these are distinct roots. So then the general theory of differential equations says that there is a basis of solutions of the form z to the beta 1 h1 z, z to the beta 2 h2 z, where h1 and h2 are holomorphic on all of the disks, including the puncture. And so the only monodromy action is here, z to the beta 1, z to the beta 2. If you remember, z to the beta 1, you can write as e to the beta 1 log z. And log z had monodromy, like z log z goes to log z plus 1. So e to the beta 1 log z goes to e to the beta 1 log z plus 1. So that is why it pulls out the scalar e to the beta 1. It's not quite e to the beta 1, e to the 2 pi I beta 1. So that's really the theory, that every solution is really holomorphic up to some horrible function like this. It's not too horrible because it's just, it has some sort of logarithmic singularity or maybe this kind of singularity, z to the beta. So the differential equation like this has nice monodromy action, provided it is a regular singular zero, the puncture is a regular singular point. So the multivaluedness of the solution comes from the multivaluedness of these functions, z to the beta 1 and z to the beta 2. If beta 1 minus beta 2 is an integer, then there is generally one more solution that has logarithmic singularity. And I don't want to complicate matters by talking about that. So let's ignore that for the time being. So another special case is same, the punctured disk, but both the functions f0 and f1, let's go back to it. This function I had assumed had at most a simple pole, and this function had at most a double pole. But now suppose you make the stronger assumption that this function has a simple pole, and so does this. This function also has a simple pole, okay? Then the result is that one of the solutions is actually holomorphic at z equal to zero, and the other solution may be singular. The other solution, of course, will look like z to the beta times holomorphic at zero. So the monodromy matrix will have a fixed vector, because if the solution is holomorphic, the monodromy action is trivial. So it will have a fixed vector. So such a matrix which has a fixed vector is usually called a complex reflection. So we can apply this theory. You know, we have, it's not much of a theory. It is just Cauchy's theorem for the disk, followed by the theory of regular singular points for differential equations of order 2 for the punctured disk. So if we apply this theory to this kind of differential equation, theta plus beta 1 minus 1, theta plus beta 2 minus 1, z theta plus alpha 1, theta plus alpha 2. Now let us look at the behavior of the space of solutions dy equal to 0 at z equal to 0. When z equal to 0, this term disappears. So the initial equation looks like t plus beta 1 minus 1 into t plus beta 2 minus 1 equal to 0. So very simple. The roots of the initial equation are just 1 minus beta 1 and 1 minus beta 2. And so what should the solutions look like? They are z to the 1 minus beta 1 times something holomorphic, z to the 1 minus beta 2 times something holomorphic. So the monodromy action is e to the 2 pi I minus beta 1 e to the 2 pi a minus beta 2. So it is multiplying by those two scalars, e to the minus 2 pi a beta 1, e to the minus 2 pi a beta 2. Two solutions of this. Remember, that's what I had said for the Gauss hypergeometric function. For the Gauss hypergeometric function, the monodromy action has characteristic roots e to the 2 pi I c, e to the 2 pi I d. But c and d have been now changed to beta 1 and beta 2, or maybe a and b, beta 1 and beta 2 minus 1. So the roots are e to the 2 pi I beta 1, e to the 2 pi I beta 2. That's what the general theory says, and that's what this says. The once you are given what the initial equation is, you are given what the characteristic roots of the monodromy matrix are, and the characteristic roots are conjugate to this companion matrices. The monodromy matrix is conjugate to this companion matrix and this companion matrix. So therefore, we have described what the characteristic roots of the companion matrix here are. It is e to the 2 pi I beta 1, e to the 2 pi I beta 2, and here also. So at least up to conjugacy, we have described what the monodromy representation is. But I am going to slur over something. In fact, it's on the nose correct. It's not just that conjugate to companion matrix. The monodromy matrix is the companion matrix corresponding to beta 1 and beta 2. And the monodromy matrix at infinity is the companion matrix corresponding to alpha 1 and alpha 2. That's all. That is the statement about the hypergeometric equation. Now, just by using this general theory, you can actually deduce that when the hypergeometric function is an algebraic function. Remember, we wanted to prove that the hypergeometric function is an algebraic function, but that is the same thing as saying that the monodromy of the hypergeometric function is finite. But it so happens that the monodromy matrix in general, whenever you have this kind of description, in general it preserves a Hermitian form, and the signature of the Hermitian form depends on the variables, depends on these variables beta 1 and beta 2, beta 1 and beta 2. So what the signature is, it will depend very much on that. And so what Schwarz did was to find out for what parameters A, B, C or beta 1 and beta 2, alpha 1 and alpha 2 is the signature of the form 2 comma 0. When is the Hermitian form positive definite? And he had a very nice solution to this, and the finiteness of the monodromy group actually amounts to finding out which are the finite subgroups of GL to C, which act irreducibly for some reason. I have not explained to you why the action should be irreducible. So what are the irreducible subgroups of GL to C? And then he determined that also. These irreducible subgroups are the dihedral group, the icosahedral group, the octahedral group, the tetrahedral group, and so on. It's a finite list. It's called Schwarz's list. You can actually look it up in the Wikipedia. So I think this kind of he also determined when the group is discrete. That is a much more delicate question. When the monodromy group is discrete, it's very nice actually, but I can't describe it in this, you know, without pictures. And I'm hampered by the fact that my technology is rather limited. So I think I should stop here. And if there are any questions, please ask.
Thank you, Professor Venkatramana. It was a really nice talk.
Thank you.
Maybe
I finished a bit early because, you know, this kind of PowerPoint talk is not something to which I'm used.
No, that's absolutely fine. No problem. If anyone has a question, you can either type it here and I can read it.
Yeah. Professor.
Can the cyclic group not arise?
Excuse me?
Cyclic group.
With the action is, if you choose the parameter correctly, that's a good question too. Okay, so I was a little bit careless. Here I have to make sure that alpha 1 minus beta 1 and alpha 2 minus beta 2, alpha 2 minus beta 1, alpha 2 minus beta 2 are not integers. That's a necessary assumption for us. In such a case, the monodromy representation on the two-dimensional space of solutions is irreducible. So once the monodromy representation is irreducible, the cyclic group cannot arise. So that is why we have to look, thank you. So I had to assume that I think somewhere I mentioned it, but not here. Let's go back. Okay, so I have to assume that this A, B, C, and D are such that the differences, D minus A, D minus B, C minus A, and C minus B are not integers. That's very important. Otherwise, you can have a kind of reducibility. And so Z can arise, but for such parameters. But Schwartz always assumes that these differences are never integers.
When do the more interesting and infinite triangle groups arise?
That is exactly when the signature is negative. A certain determinant is negative. We can find out the signature of the of this equation. I said that the monodromy group preserves a Hermitian form. The signature of the Hermitian form depends on the parameters. Okay? And I should have exhibited that somewhere. That signature of the Hermitian form forgotten actually. How it depends on the parameter is so I can tell you when is it finite, when is the group finite. There is a nice way of saying it. So if the group is finite if and only if beta 1 and beta 2 are between 0 and 1, alpha 1 and alpha 2 are between 0 and 1, and they intertwine. They are rational numbers. Beta 1, beta 2 are rational numbers. Alpha 1, alpha 2 are rational numbers. And they intertwine. That is, between beta 1 and beta 2, there is an alpha. And between alpha 1 and alpha 2, there is a beta. Then they intertwine. If these two intertwine, it's called the Schwartz intertwining condition, then the monodromy group is finite. If they don't intertwine, then the monodromy group is infinite. Okay, so it is infinite always when the roots don't intertwine. The roots of these initial equations do not intertwine, then the monodromy group is infinite. Yeah. That's the solution. But there is an even more interesting thing. When the monodromy group is discrete, that is much harder. It's also in terms of something called Schwarz integrality conditions, but I don't want to talk about it. It's a little bit complicated, so let me skip it. But just want to tell you that it's a very interesting condition. Yeah, so it is this intertwining condition. This has been generalized, actually. It is called, this generalization is due to Boikers and Heckman. They replace this second order by nth order. Again, they determine when this nth order hypergeometric equation has finite monodromy, exactly when the roots beta I and the roots alpha I intertwine. So if there is no intertwining condition, then the solution is infinite.
Can all the finite group in the general case, can all the finite groups of GL and C can arise?
No, these are finite groups which are three generated, which are two generated, only two generated. That's the necessary condition. And also they preserve.
You're considering the quadratic.
It's the nth order equation, but yeah. The singularities are again, the differential equation is again on P1 minus 3 points, 0, 1, and infinity.
I see.
So it is still two generated. So all these things are two generated, but not all of them arise. There are some kind of special things. They give a list. In fact, they are generated. They are generated by complex reflections or something. You know, something like that. Yeah, they have some condition. So and there is a list of these due to somebody. Shepard and Todd, which are the finite groups generated by complex reflections. So they use that. They use that classification.
I think Shevale has a classification of that, right?
That is a complex reflection in the sense of this, but I'm talking about the about complex reflections, not the reflection groups.
Shevale, I think, classified the finite complex reflection groups.
Shevale. No. I'm talking about finite subgroups of GL and C.
Yes.
For a given N, what is the classification? Shepard and Todd have a kind of systematic classification on this.
Oh.
Yes, there is a general theorem of Shevale, but that's a little different. Yeah. So, okay, thanks very much.
Thank you very much for your very interesting expository talk.
Let's just see if there are any questions on YouTube.
Supriya, none so far, so I'm following it.
Okay.
I have one question, sir.
Yeah.
So this I have read that.
I have to show you. Who is asking? Is it Devendra? Devendra. Okay.
So some elliptic integrals can be considered as a hypergeometric, like classically in 19th century, people consider that. But this elliptic integral corresponding to Weierstrass function, if it is also related to some hypergeometric function.
Yes, they are related actually. There the parameters look like, I think Professor Kulkarni should be able to tell us, beta 1 is half, beta 2 is half, something like that.
Yeah, this f half, half 1 and c square.
Yeah, something like that.
So it is elliptic integral of first kind, and then second kind would be minus half, half 1.
I should actually have talked about that also, because you know the Schwarz hypergeometric function, Gauss hypergeometric function is related to what is called P1 period integrals on certain cyclic coverings of P1 minus 3 points.
Okay.
The elliptic curve is also a cyclic covering, namely a two-sheeted covering of P1 minus 3 points. So it's exactly like this. So it's a special case.
So this Weierstrass P function relates with the hypergeometric theory, right?
Yeah, they do.
Now, could you suggest any reference where I can find any chapter or paper?
Okay, cyclic coverings of P1. You know, there is a book by why don't you do a Google search? I also did that. Dutch mathematician who has written a Springer lecture notes on cyclic coverings of Rohde, R-O-H-D-E, Rohde.
Okay.
So he has written a book on cyclic coverings of P1, and I think he treats this elliptic functions as a special case very early on in that book.
Okay.
But he considers much more general cyclic covers, but you know, you can just look at.
Thanks. Thank you, sir.
Okay, 1 month. Sure.
So, thank you, Professor Venkata Ramana. It was really a nice talk. Thanks a lot for your time.
Sure. Thank you. So, from now on, I will be able to attend the as an audience, with which I'm much more happy. Thanks.
Yeah.
So let me just mention here that next Tuesday, the talks will be by Professor Alexander Mednick at 4 p.m. and then by Professor John Parker at 5:30 p.m.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Vivek,
Christian Rodriguez.
Vivek, are you going to...